Good morning. It is awesome to see you. Let's pray together, and then we're going to jump into God's Word together. Oh, infinite and intimate One, we thank you for your grandeur and your majesty. We thank you for your personal interest in each of us. And we surrender. We give ourselves to you in this moment that you might speak to us. I give myself that you might speak through me. We all give our ears that you might speak to us. None of us here by accident, Lord. It's a sermon on marriage, and I know that there's some single folks who are probably sitting there thinking, why am I here? And I know you have something for them too, something for relationships, maybe some way that they can encourage someone that they know that's married, maybe a way to pour into their children or grandchildren. I don't know, but I know none of us are here or listening by accident, and so we offer ourselves to you, and we pray you would encourage and challenge us. And I just pray you'd speak through me. I give this time to you, Jesus, in your name. Amen. If you have your Bible, could you please open it to Genesis chapter 2? Genesis chapter 2. I made a mistake when I was a teenager. I think I did it two or three times. I regret it to this day. I was sitting around, it was summer break, and I'd kind of run out of things to do. I was watching TV, but the TV wasn't doing much for me. And my dad walked into the room and he said, "What are you up to?" And I said, "I'm bored." That was my mistake, just those two little words. I'm bored. And my dad looked at me and he said, "Peter, boredom is a choice. Read a book." And walked out of the room. He said, "There's hundreds of books in the house. Pick one, read it. By noon, you won't be bored anymore." And that was all I got from him, that boredom is a choice. But you know, my dad's right. Boredom is a choice. It's the result of apathy and laziness and a lack of creativity. We bring it on ourselves. And when you look at everything our world has to offer, you realize there's really no excuse ever to be bored, that we choose to be. And some of us even find ourselves bored in our marriages, don't we? Saul Bellow said, and I quote, "Boredom is the conviction that you can't change, the shriek of unused capacities," end quote. The shriek of unused capacities. See, this is what happens in marriage. We get to a certain point. We've been together for a certain amount of time. And we realize we're just kind of in this rut, which of course is just a grave with the ends knocked out. We're in this rut. Can't really seem to get out of it. We look at the other person, we're thinking they haven't changed in this amount of time, they're probably never going to change. I'm not going to change. We're not changing. This is the way it is. We have no choice but to be bored. I heard an ad on the radio this week. It was a woman's voice, and she came on in a quite shrill and strong voice. She said, and I quote, "Anyone who says money can't make you happy has never paid for a divorce," end quote. Wow. Anyone who says money can't make you happy has never paid for a divorce. She was a family attorney. She was trolling on the radio for people who are bored in their marriages. And here's what she's selling. She's selling, if you're bored, hey, it can be better. Just dump the bum. And then life will get better. You'll be happy. I've been in ministry over almost 30 years now, and I've never met anyone shortly after a divorce who would say, "Happy, happy." She's lying. And people are buying her lie because they're bored. Don't raise your hand or anything, but let me just ask you the question. Are you bored in your marriage? Are you bored? Gary Thomas says, "Divorce rates testify to the fact that spouses who were once enthralled with each other eventually get bored with each other." Friends, listen. None of us is so enthralling that we can keep someone enchanted for 5 decades. None of us are so enthralling that we can keep someone enchanted for 5 decades. 5 dates? Sure. 5 years? Maybe. 5 decades? Good luck. This is a God thing, friends. The only way we stay enchanted with one another for 40, 50, 60 years is if God makes it happen, if Christ produces it. Vibrancy is possible, but only in him. All relationships are teleological. That simply means that all relationships are going somewhere. They are moving in one direction or another. They're living and alive and becoming something. And my question for you today is, are you becoming bored or are you becoming vibrant? Which direction is your marriage moving? Because the way it tends to work in our culture is you get bored, you settle for boredom, you get more bored, then you get divorced. It's what happens day after day. Earl Nightingale said, "You'll find boredom where there is the absence of a good idea. You'll find boredom where there is the absence of a good idea." I think he's almost right. I think you'll find boredom where there's the absence of a God idea. There's a lot of great God ideas in Scripture to help us keep our marriages vital and vibrant and avoid boredom. So I'm going to share with you four God ideas today, straight out of Scripture, four areas of life where if we allow Jesus to take control, vibrancy will find our lives full of vibrancy. And if we even allow him to take control of one, we'll be less bored than we are now. I'm going to tell you, if you allow in the next year Christ to take control of all four of these areas and breathe life into all four of these areas, you will have a vibrant marriage. Boredom will be in the rearview mirror. Okay? So if you want to hear what they are, I'm going to walk you through them. I'm taking them from the creation account of the very first marriage. This is before the fall. This is before everything got messed up. This is a picture of what marriage could be. And in Christ, because he wants to redeem what was fallen, he can actually produce this in us if we let him. Four God ideas. Number one, starting in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15, companionship. Companionship. There's so much in the text, I'm just going to read it to you so you can see the companionship here. "The Lord God took the man," that's Adam, "and he put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, 'You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die.' And the Lord God said," underline these words, "'It is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him.'" God placed man in literal paradise, gave him a great job to do. But he said, "I'm still not done. It's not right yet. It is not good." All the way through the creation account, God said, and God created this, and it was good. And God created this, and it was good. And God created this, and it was good. And then on the day that he created Adam and Eve, and God created Adam and Eve, and it was very good. Good, 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 very good. This is the first time that not good has shown up in the biblical account. And what is not good? That Adam is alone. He doesn't have a companion. He doesn't have a partner in life. It's not good. What he was wanting for him was a helper suitable for him. The word helper is azer. It's used of God almost every other time it's used in Scripture. It's used of someone who is a protector or a helper or a partner, a comrade, if you will. The word suitable means like what is in front of him, a mirror image, if you will, a complement to him, a correspondence. Companionship is what's being described here. There's all these animals, there's all these birds, there's all these fish, and there's Adam, and he's alone, and he needs someone like him to go through life with. If you see in verse 20, "But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. And then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. And the man said, 'This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man.'" Adam says, "Yes, here's someone I can share life with." Companionship. I see Betty sitting out here. Hi, Betty. I'm going to talk about you and Dwight for a second. Is that okay? Betty and Dwight were married 65 years. And Dwight recently passed away. And that's a long time to be married. It's a long time to be companions, to be partners in life. And when I went home and shared with Libby that Dwight had passed away, we were in the kitchen with Liam, and we just had a great conversation about what it would be like to get that much time with someone. What a gift. and also how hard it would be when it wasn't that way anymore, right? And we started talking about what we would miss the most after 65 years together. And we were talking about different things because there's so much about marriage that's so beautiful. And Libby and I both landed on the same place. It was this. It would be the companionship. It would be the partnership. It would be sharing life together. Sharing what happened during the day, certainly, but sharing the tears and sharing the laughter, sharing the outrageous frustration. Teenagers. Sharing the learnings. And as I thought about this companionship with Libby and me, we don't have a perfect marriage. We got a rich, vibrant marriage, and a lot of it is because of the companionship we feel as we learn together. We've always learned together, and that breathes such life into our marriage. The thing we've learned most about together is Jesus. We've just spent our life learning about him. In fact, when we were still dating, before we were even engaged, I believe, we took a seminary class together. You're like, wow, Pete, you know how to show a girl a good time. We took a class with D.A. Carson on 1 Corinthians, and we just ate it up, and we went back to our apartment or to her house, and we sat down, and we talked with our Bible open, and we grappled with what we were learning, and we agreed, and we disagreed, and it was awesome. We were learning together, and that launched us into a life of learning. And a number of years ago, Libby found herself in a place where she was saying, you know what? This Christian life I'm trying to live, it doesn't work. I'm trying to perform, trying to please him, it just doesn't work. And she's honest. She was honest with herself, and she was honest with God, and she poured her heart out to him, and she begged him to reveal himself in a new and fresh way so that she could see how it could work. And he started to answer her prayer, and she started to grow like crazy. And Jesus started to reveal himself like crazy. And she and I started talking, and at first, because it was kind of still working for me, we kind of got into a little conflict with some of our conversations, and then over time, it stopped working for me too. The whole performance thing, and I just started to learn from my wife, and we started to learn together, and we started to do a deep dive, and not only did we grow exponentially in our walk with Jesus, but we grew together because we were learning together. We're still learning. Libby sent me a link to a sermon recently of a pastor. She said, this guy's teaching grace, but I think he's off. Let's listen and talk about this together. And so I listened to the message, and sure enough, he started to veer off, and by the end of the message, he had veered way off into a heresy called inclusionism, which is just a new word for universalism. And it was really dangerous and really scary as I listened to him teach. And we sat down and we were watching the video together, and we were talking about how he was doing it and how he was twisting the text and how he was manipulating the people in the congregation. And we got angry together. When was the last time you got angry together towards something that was appropriate to be angry about? It's because we have this culture in our marriage of learning together. Libby is constantly sending me articles. And you don't have to read this today, but by tomorrow would be great. Ooh, okay, I'll try to get that. And we're learning and we're growing. We're learning about health. We're learning about nutrition for a lot of different reasons. We're learning about what's good to eat and what's not good to eat. And our journey has taken us recently to a farmer's market in McKinney on a Saturday morning with the rain drizzling down, and we're under an umbrella, and we're meeting these fascinating people who live on farms and try to produce healthy food for us, and we hear the passion in their voice for what they're doing, and we're doing it together, and we're learning. And what are you learning together? Are you learning anything together? When was the last time you learned something about Jesus together? When was the last time as a couple you had a conversation about Jesus, about what he's doing, about how you're growing in your understanding of him, about what he's challenging you on? How are you learning? Boring marriages report on the happenings of the day. Vibrant marriages discover things. I saw Betty a couple weeks after Dwight died. She came up and I prayed with her. And I looked at her and I said, Betty, you just look so beautiful, so beautiful. And here's what she said to me. She said, oh, Pete, I am so lonely. But I've decided I'm going to keep living because I got a lot of life left in me. You see, what Betty understands is it's beautiful to have that companionship and that partnership. You don't have to have it. With Christ, you don't have to have that. You can be vibrant and full and alive alone with Jesus. Many of you have experienced that. Many of you are experiencing that. But when you're married, don't give up on the companionship piece because you get so distracted on other things. Lean into partnering together and learning together. And Jesus can breathe vibrancy into your marriage. That's the first one, companionship. Here's the second God idea, straight out of Genesis chapter 2, verse 24. I'm going to call it cuddling. It's a euphemism. Cuddling for physical intimacy or sex. Verse 24. This is why. Why? Because they're companions. This is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife. Why oneness happens. And they become one flesh. That's talking about sexual intimacy. Sexual intimacy is a demonstration of true personal oneness, which is a demonstration of this companionship that God desperately wants us to have. Adam and Eve were both naked and they felt no shame. Adam and Eve were both naked and they were having a good time. It's great when you're married and naked. It's awesome. It is. It's what he gave us as a gift. Marital sex is fun, it's awesome, it's beautiful, it's also deeply significant. Deeply significant. Some people say sex is a parakeet. A number of years ago, before they came up with sophisticated equipment, miners would go down deep into the earth, into these mines. And many times the stone that they were working with would release some toxic gases, but they were gases that you couldn't smell, and so many times miners would die without even realizing the gases were in the chamber. And so they came up with a strategy. They took a little parakeet down in a cage, and parakeet's lungs are very tiny, and they can't really process the poison very well. And so they would be working away, and they would keep an eye on the parakeet, and if all of a sudden the parakeet started going, boom. If the parakeet died, they knew there were poisonous fumes and gases, and they got out as quickly as they could. Some people say that sex is the parakeet of marriage. Follow me. When your sex life has died, there's poison in the air. There's trouble. Boring marriages stop having sex. Vibrant marriages keep it alive. You say, Pete, you know, when you get a little older, it's a little tougher, and it's just hard, and yeah, I know. But vibrant marriages figure out a way to keep it alive. They figure it out. I love what Dr. Julie Slattery said. She said that long-term marital sexuality is less like a Tonka truck and more like a Lego game. A Lego set. Let me explain what I mean, what she means. A Tonka truck comes out of the box ready to play with, right out of the box. I mean, as soon as you got it, whoo, you're off and running. And 15, 20, 40 years later, that same little truck works exactly the same way. It's a Tonka truck. Sex is not like that. Sex is more like a Lego set. When you get a Lego set, remember, men, your first Lego set, you were so excited. Maybe some of you girls got one too. And what do you do with a Lego set? You build stuff. And so you built a little boat. And then you played with the boat for like 3 minutes. And then you broke it all up, dismantled it. And then you built a car. And you played with the car for 3 or 4 minutes. And then you dismantled it. And you built a castle. And then you dismantled it. And that's what you do with Lego, is you build something, and then you dismantle it. And you build it, and you dismantle something else. That's what sex is like. Over the years, it's not always like it is right when you take it out of the box. Life changes. The way we have to do this changes as well. You go on your honeymoon. It's like you build a little sports car with your Lego. Right? But a little later, you know, a year, 2 years later, things are starting to change. It's a little bit more routine. And then the kids come along, and there's pregnancy, and there's nursing, and there's 3 a.m. wake-ups for a kid in the other room. That really helps, right? And then those kids turn into teenagers. That's a whole different season. And then they leave and we're empty nesters. And then as we get older, our bodies start to break down. And all these different seasons, if we think it's still the little sports car, we're going to be deeply disappointed. It's not the sports car anymore. It's a new season. Dismantle the sports car and build something else. A rocking chair. Something else. What do you want to build? Here's the cool thing. You get to build what you want to build. You have conversations about it. Instead of just saying, well, it was great on the honeymoon, but it can't be like that anymore. I guess we'll quit. No. Dismantle. Rebuild. Figure it out. Have conversations. Talk about it. Women, I want to chat with you for a second. I learned something about men just this week reading that I think might be helpful for you to understand. Husbands walk around with less oxytocin in their lives than wives do. Oxytocin is a neurochemical that creates feelings of warmth and attraction and affection. Women have high levels of this, men not so much. If a certain man in a marriage has a little lower level than normal and a woman has a higher level than normal, the difference can be a factor of 10. I mean, it can be an enormous difference, which means that the woman feels warmth and affection almost all the time towards her husband, the husband not so much. It's kind of the way we're wired chemically. There is one time in the human experience, however, that the husband's level approaches that of the wife's. And it is right after sexual intimacy. In that moment, the level just goes, which means, ladies, there is no time that your husband feels more warmth and affection towards you than in that very special time. So if you long for your husband to be more warm and affectionate towards you, I just gave you a little tip. Free of charge, no extra charge. Men, serve your wife in the bedroom. This is an opportunity to give, not get. Talk to her. Find out how you can serve her, how you can love her, how you can care for her. I promise you, if you listen well and respond, it will go well with you. I know, please hear me, I know that in this specific area, there can be enormous amounts of baggage, and I don't pretend to understand all that. But what I do know is that the couples that stay vibrant in their marriage more often than not have a vibrant sex life, no matter how old they are, as they've rebuilt it the way that they can in this season of life. I can't say it any better than Jen Hatmaker says it in her book, For the Love. She says, and I quote, "Have lots of sex. This is just really sincerely a thing. Whether the guy way, make love to feel loved, or the girl way, make love because you feel loved, at the end of 12 minutes, you're both happy." End quote. And I'm just going to leave it right there, and we'll go on to the next one. We got companionship. We got cuddling. Number three, great God idea, children. Children. Usually the result of cuddling. Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, God blessed Adam and Eve, and he said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it." He said, have babies, have children, bring children into your marriage. There's lots of reasons why God told them to bring children into the world. The survival of mankind, obviously, is number one at the top of the list. But shortly after that is for vibrancy in marriage. Children are designed to bring depth and beauty to our marriage. Children are little projects for married couples to work on together. Have you ever thought of your kids that way? Each one of them is like a little project, and together as a couple, you join forces to raise this child. Boring marriages are driving children around. Vibrant marriages are training children up. boring marriages or driving children around. The reason we're driving them around is because their lives are full of so many activities that their life has become more important than our marriage. Their activities has become more important than our marriage. I remember another conversation I had with my dad. I was a teenager again, and I wanted him to do something for me, but for him to do it for me would have precluded him doing something with my mom, his wife, that he had already promised to do. And I was very upset that he wouldn't do this thing for me, and I got kind of ugly, and I started to go after him. And eventually he did what he did when he wanted me to stop talking. He put his finger in the air like this, and he pointed at me, and I'm like, Peter? Do not forget that you are a guest in my home. He said, your mother and I were together long before you arrived. We will be together long after you leave. Do not forget your place. He was right, by the way. My parents have been empty nesters after I left for college now for 34 years. They were together long after I left. They were not allowed to get little teenage snotty-nosed kid get between their marriage. Now that's a British kind of stiff upper lip way to say this, but the principle is good because, you see, our American way is to make our children the most important thing in our homes. And we do this by filling their lives with activities that will make us look good or will get them to Harvard. And our marriages are suffering for it. Are your kids' activities swallowing up your marriage? I mean, just honestly ask yourself that. If they are, I can guarantee you, you're bored in your marriage. Because if you never get any time together, you get bored of each other. I remember when our eldest, Cameron, was starting to play football at Hebron High School. The football coach, their coach, Brazel, called all the freshman parents in for a meeting, and we sat all down, and the first question he asked was, how many of you hope your son gets a scholarship one day? And of course, almost every hand in the room went up. My kid's going to get a scholarship. He said, okay, I'm going to show you a guaranteed way for your kids to get scholarships. Get our notes out. What is it? Here it is. Write this down, he said. We're ready. Tell your kids to hit the books. Thought you were going to tell us how to get scholarships. He said, you know, for every one athletic scholarship in college, there are 10 academic scholarships. This was a 6A football program in Texas. And he said, the year before, three of our boys got athletic scholarships to play football at university. Three. And he said, in this high school, hundreds of kids got academic scholarships to go to college. Tell your kids to hit the books. What is this obsession with our children getting athletic scholarships? Friends, I'm going to break it to you. It's probably not going to happen. But get a good score on your SAT, your 40 time is irrelevant. Yet, we invest so heavily in providing opportunities for our kids that may never pan out. And we spend our life in the car as a result. Vibrant marriages don't think of it that way. They think, how can we train these children up to know and love Jesus and to walk in Him? There's such a joy in training children together. It's hard work. There's disagreements. There's conversations. There's divergent forms of discipline that you've got to work through. There's engagement together. There's goal setting. There's discipline. It's hard. But it's not boring. Not boring. Our youngest is the only one home now. Our two eldest have flown the coop. And Liam is 16, and this last summer was a great summer. It was that great summer in a kid's life, you know. He got his braces off. He got his driver's license. He's working two jobs. He buys his car that he's been saving since he was 11 years old for. He steps into a rigorous academic schedule. He's playing football. He's growing taller. It's just this, and he spends most of the evenings in the kitchen with us, chatting and making us laugh. And it is such joy to be raising and training a child together. Companionship, cuddling, children, the fourth word, contribution. Contribution. Chapter 1, verse 28 of Genesis, to both Adam and Eve, God said this, "Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the air and over every living creature that moves along the ground. You're in charge, guys. I created it. You run it." And then God said, "I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth." Okay, that's a lot of plants. "I give them all to you and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds in the sky and the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food." And it was so. Adam and Eve were given a job to do, a contribution to make together. Rule over the creation that I have made. There's such joy, friends, in locking arms and serving together, in figuring out not only what do you have for me, Jesus, what do you want to do through me, but what do you have for us, Jesus? What do you want to do through us as a couple? Boring marriages serve themselves. Vibrant marriages serve others together. A few weeks ago, we were in Milwaukee, and there's a wonderful couple at Bentry, Milwaukee, who took us for a ride down the Milwaukee River in their boat. And it's a wonderful view of the city down from the river. And they went out on Lake Michigan and brought us back. And we heard their story while we were on the boat. And they had empty nesters. Their kids are off at college or married. And they're kind of on their own. And they had a large house out on the west side of town with a lake and all the lake toys and all that kind of stuff. And it was just a lot to keep with no kids around. And they're like, you know what? Why don't we go ahead and downsize? But then God gave them a vision. And so they sold their place out there. And they moved down to the Third Ward downtown. And they got a condo right on the river. And God sent them there to reach people for Christ. They have a mission. They want to point people to Jesus. And the way that he's led them to do this is to put together a little furniture boutique kind of furniture store right in the heart of the Third Ward so that they can get to know people, get to know the business community, and start to reach people for Christ. And they're sharing their story. And as you looked at them, you would have sworn they were 26 years old. The life and the excitement and the vitality. They're having a devil of a time figuring out how to do it. I mean, they're starting a business. It's really hard. They're running into roadblocks all over the place, but they're doing it together. And there's a vibrancy in their marriage as a result. The strongest marriages I've ever known are those who do ministry together, bar none. Matthew 6:33 says, "But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." It's true of us as individuals. Seek Jesus and his righteousness first, and he fills his life with what we need. As a couple, if we seek him first, his righteousness, his kingdom first, he'll fill in our marriage gaps too. As one author says it, "When we give our lives away, we find them. When we focus outside our marriages, we end up strengthening our marriages." We have scores of couples around Bentry who pour into people, who serve people, and their marriages are stronger as a result. I want to introduce you to one. Many of you know them, the Johnson family. Please listen to their story.
You ready? And scene.
My name is Brian David Johnson. This is my wife, Karen Ann Johnson. We've been married way too long.
But he probably needs us to do that right in case they want to use the clip. I don't know.
No, they're not going to introduce that way.
For us, living on mission really allows us to get outside of ourselves and to think of things beyond what's going on in our own little circle with our families or our children or whatever. But to think outside and to look to others and what their needs are and what's going on in the world really helps take focus off our own self and our own self and our relationship as well.
As we continued forward, God really gave us opportunities to serve together, and it looked different in every area, but sometimes Karen was on the front, sometimes I was in the front, sometimes we were together, but just by saying yes, it gave us the opportunity to really be out there serving God as a team.
Last night in our small group, we were just studying in Philippians 1, where Paul talks about rejoicing because the gospel is going out. And so we were just discussing that this morning about how can we not rejoice when we experience firsthand the effects of the gospel, the effects that Jesus has on people's lives, and the changes that we see happen. How can you not rejoice over that? So we get to experience that on a daily basis, that joy and rejoicing as the gospel is extended.
One blessing that's been really for us is the legacy that we're giving to our kids. Our kids have had to sacrifice as we brought people into our home, as we've used our time and treasure to go on missions together, but they've seen the fruit of that as well. So it's just not about our marriage, it's about the legacy that we give our kids and that what they're gonna bring into the relationship.
Yeah, and we're seeing that become their passion too.
Right.
We're seeing them develop their own passions for missions.
Yeah. Any couple out there, I would encourage you, like, just say yes. The passion that you're gonna have to do missions together is just a true blessing that you won't get in any other way. And the fruit of being able to see what God's doing in the kingdom together as a team is just really more than I can imagine at times. And the legacy that we get to leave our friends and family to see what living on life on missions looks like, I mean, it's a blessing that we just get to celebrate all the time. Mm-hmm.
Karen referenced their small group after about almost a year of trying to schedule it. Libby and I got to go and visit with their small group one night. And it's all these young 20-something, 30-something couples just getting started in life, having babies at home. And it was so cool seeing Brian and Karen just pouring into them. And what an incredible gift. But then to know behind the scenes that God is pouring into their marriage as a result of that, it's a win-win. Right? It's an incredible way to grow together. So here's your homework, last homework of the year for our marriage series. I'd love for you to have a conversation at some point in this next week and just ask an honest question of each other. Are we bored? Don't answer now. Are we bored? Every relationship is teleological. Which way are we moving? Are we moving towards boredom? Or are we moving towards vibrancy? Which way are we going? If you admit that there's boredom creeping in or you are bored as a couple, then I'd encourage you to look at all four of these areas, surrender them to Jesus. I mean, really bring them to him and say, Jesus, we know you can do something supernatural and dynamic in each of these areas. We want to ask you to do that. We want to purposely see you work in these areas. In fact, we would love to see you transform all four of these because we want vibrancy in our marriage and our life. So companionship. Here's an idea for you as far as companionship is concerned. Learn something new together this next year. This week, just sit down and talk. What do we want to learn? Let's learn about something. Maybe it's something you've always wanted to learn about. It doesn't have to be anything deep, or it just can be anything simple. I just saw a Groupon this last week, and I sent it to Libby. I said, can we do this? And it's just a one-night art class where they teach you how to paint. Just look fun. We're going to go learn how to paint for a few hours. It doesn't have to be huge. Just figure out something that you can learn together and dive into it this next year. Cuddling. If this is a struggle for you guys, if the parakeet has kind of done a face plant in your home, then I encourage you to read Song of Solomon, and I'm serious about that. Just set some time aside some evenings, lock the bedroom door, get your Bible out, read Song of Solomon, and see how the Lord leads. If you need to, schedule sex. It's not against the rules. You can do that. Get it on the calendar. Talk about how you want it to go. Talk about what it would look like to dismantle the Lego thing that you've been putting on the shelf for a few years and creating something new in this new season of life. Children, have a conversation about whether your kids are really running your home or not. I mean, really, honestly, talk about it. If their activities are swamping your marriage, and figure out what changes you need to make to stop that from happening. And then ask yourself the question, for each of our kids that are still at home, how can we help them develop? What's one thing together as a team we can work on together to help them develop and grow in this next year? And come up with some strategies for that. contribution. If you're not serving in ministry, if you're not serving together in ministry, pray about how you might step into that together. Maybe you could step into the marriage mentor ministry. Incredible, rich experience of pouring into a young couple or a couple that's struggling, and you'd be amazed at what it would do for your marriage as well. Even as I preach these things, I'm aware that for some of you, because of varying circumstances, some of these things are impossible. The children thing, some of you have never been able to have kids, and so even me mentioning that is painful. Some of you are just struggling in some of these areas, and I just remember, your marriage is completely unique, and take what you can take before the Lord and before one another and see what he can do. And I anticipate him doing great things in your life. I'd like to make a declaration. I'd like to declare this the year at Bent Tree where we will eradicate boredom from our marriages. What do you say? That sound good? Like, no more boredom in our marriages. We're waging war on boredom, right? So let's try that. You need to know, those of you who are clapping, I should have told you this before you clapped, it'll cost you a few rounds of golf. It'll cost you a few days at the spa. It'll cost you a few football games on Saturday afternoon. If you're going to prioritize going deep, fostering your companionship, it's going to cost a little bit, but it's really, really worth it. And the choice is yours. It really is. Boredom is a choice. If you're bored, you chose it. My encouragement is for you to take this to Jesus and have him do a work. Please stand with me. I'd love to pray for you. And if you're a married couple and you sense a little boredom in your life and in your marriage, or you'd like God to bring more vibrancy, I encourage you to hold hands right now. And if you want, just hold them over your head saying, yeah, Jesus, us. We would love to see this in our marriage. I'm going to bow my head and close my eyes and pray for you. Lord Jesus, thank you for marriage. It's an absolutely awesome idea. And yet we are in this broken world, and so there's challenges and there's struggles. And one of the things we struggle with is we get bored. None of us are so enthralling that we can keep someone enchanted for 50 years. We need you to do that for us. We need you to breathe the vitality into our relationship. So, Jesus, we make ourselves available that you might do that. Thank you for giving us these four categories to think about, to talk about, to maybe plan for. But at the end of the day, Lord Jesus, we need you to supernaturally transform these areas of our lives so that we can grow closer and more intimate. Thank you for loving us the way you do. Thank you for providing your life to make it all possible. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.